Here I met Bill Aitken, a remarkable Scottish writer who has lived in these hills for the past 40 years.
The amusing thing about the empire attitude that we started everything, we started the idea of hill stations where we estivated and cut the summer heat. But in actual fact, it was the Hindu gods who started this notion of wintering in the lower regions and spending their summer in the snowy heights. They long before the Alpine Club was founded, the Hindu gods had cottoned on to the idea that this is a great place to be in the hot weather.
We're so used to the very Indianness and sort of exoticism of seeing Hindus bathing in rivers. But as you point out in your book, it's not a very different idea at all from the Western idea of baptism. Is that so?
The moment you travel, you suddenly discover the world is the same everywhere. The ideas, the depths of idea changes, but basically there's no difference.
So Bill, what have I got ahead of me up the Ganges?
Many people set off to the source of the Ganga, but unless the goddess pulls you, kenshows you, you do not arrive. This is the absolute universal belief and people's experience that unless you're intended to arrive, you will not.
Yes. The Deccan is wonderful. Thousands of kilometers of this bouldered terrain. So I wanted to write about the topography, history, religion of the Deccan, which is a little covered area. So I wrote a book called Divining the Deccan.
Divining the Deccan. And yeah. You did just that,
A motorbike journey from Shirdi to Puttaparthi, about 750 kilometers.
Amazing.
Stopping off at all the little places people don't usually visit. And in that book, I had mentioned staying a few days at Puttaparthi. And someone who read this chapter then suggested, why don't you do a full-length Life of Sai Baba? Because they'd liked how I'd presented him.
And before you go on, what caused you to stop for a few days in Puttaparthi? Just another...
Well, I'd been coming since the 70s.
Okay, so you
partly
were...
Partly because my companion on the inner path is a great devotee of Sai Baba, Ranima.
Mm-hmm. I don't work on this thing of spiritual life. I live as Prithvi. And I have a relationship with Sai Baba, which is so fantastic. I couldn't ask for more. You see, finding Baba was the real thing, wasn't it? And he, for me, is the greatest of all. Oh, he could do anything. He was magic. And still is magic.
And you've been seeing him many, many times for all these years. Each day as you sit there on the bench as Baba comes in for darshan, do you still feel the same excitement as you did years ago?
Would I come if I didn't? I had better things to do. But I love him so much, I don't think any person or anybody could give the thrill, the ecstasy that you can get from him by one look, and he looks at me every day.
And also the Deccan being, till recently, a comparatively backward area, it had very interesting steam railway remnants.
So you could report on those with your book.
Well, I came to India to study comparative religion, but I found comparative railways much more interesting.
That's sort of a metaphor, isn't it?
Exactly, exactly.
And throw in the rocks and you have the whole universe.
Yes.
Yeah, so you said you came here with your companion back in the 70s, because she was a follower of Sathya Sai Baba. Did any of that rub off on you? I mean, that's...
Well, obviously, I wouldn't have been able to write the book. I mean, an awful lot rubbed off.
Well, I say that because of your comment to me yesterday that I asked if you were a Baba devotee, and you said, no, you're not.
Not in that technical sense that, I mean, in India, I mean, it's normal to have a guru and belong to some sect or group. and then they more or less insist, like the living religions, that if you're initiated or born into this cult, that's it, buddy. you stick. In fact, my own guru's guru, when he was an English professor way back in 1930, he came to India, and his guru said to him, "I'm only going to give you initiation if you promise to stick. Otherwise, we do tend to wander."
Well, a friend of mine this morning, in characterizing what he feels your relationship might be with Sai Baba, is, he said, "No, I don't think he is a devotee of Sai Baba. I think he's a man who loves Sai Baba." Yeah. And he said, "Furthermore, I don't think any of us can decide if we're devotees. Devotees are somebody Sai Baba decides upon."
Yeah.
So, back to the story. You're in Puttaparthi, and you know a little bit about this village now. You know a lot about the rock formations, and your and your editor is putting two and two together and saying, "How about a book on Sai Baba?"
No, this wasn't the editor. This was a devotee, if you like. I mean, an old a student who'd been to Sai Baba's college and is a member of the, what you can call the higher echelons of administration in the ashram. And this person liked this chapter, and I'm assuming that she liked this chapter, because then she said, "You can do it." And I said, "I'm reluctant to do it because I feel it should be done by a devotee who has the sort of the passion to go into all the biographical details, you know, search the archives. I don't know Telugu, and I'm just too much of a slob to want to go into all these sort of nitty-gritties."
I doubt that, but perhaps a non-devotee could bring a greater sense of objectivity.
Well, this is what she wanted. When she read that first description, which was quite, sympathetic but also detached, she sort of thought this should appeal to the Indian intelligentsia, who have a terrible sort of proscription against Sai Baba.
And why is that?
It's fashionable to be seen against anything popular.
That simple?
No, it's much more complicated than that. It's partly because India wants to be seen as modern and rejecting all this God-man stuff, that we don't have to be spiritual. Let's be, modern technology, sending space probes to the moon and so on. Now, there are several reasons, but a lot of it is the natural outcome of independence, pride.
So did you reluctantly agree to take on this task?
Very, very reluctantly.
And what pushed you over the top? Her persuasiveness?
No, Ranima.
Ranima. And describe her for those people who aren't, because I had the pleasure to interview her.
Well, if you've seen a steamroller.
Well, she hardly resembles a steamroller.
No, but I mean in her sort of...
Yes,
in her
power of persuasion.
Yeah, they say that the Punjabi is the Texan of India. And she tends to win most arguments, not by persuasion, but by just sheer wearing down.
That's a wonderful line.
So there was no point in opposing her if she said, "Do it." I try.
And having worked with her for many, many years.
Well, she is also... my guru bhan, that she shares my former guru. I used to live in an ashram when I came to India. I joined first a Gandhian ashram because I was interested in the so-called good life, but it turned out to be too simple for my complicated mentality. Then I moved to an orthodox Indian ashram, Hindu ashram, which was a very good sort of, broke all the sort of Scottish, limited thinking that I had. And then this lady came along with her steamroller, and I fell in love with this lady, and my guru said, "Right, if you're in love, that is the way to the goal. Go join her, be her secretary, and earn your living like most people, and see how the other half live and have to pay the taxes instead of running away to all the spirituality, so-called."
So maybe it's safe to say, behind this wonderful book, stand two powerful women who were persuasive in pointing you in the right direction.
Precisely.
Let me ask you then about once you got into this process, probably it's taken you several years perhaps to write this book?
No. It's, say, 2 years from start to finish, of which 1 year was, I finished it and I gave it to Penguin in January 2003, and the project was suggested to me in December 2000 and when? 2000. It was 2 years. The actual writing was about 3 to 4 months.
And are you happy with the book?
I'm happy with the book, yeah, because it was for me very onerous in the beginning, because as I say, research wise, I wasn't really inspired. I had Kasturi's books, which I find can be sometimes infuriating